CNBC TV18 Young Turks Conclave, powered by SBI YONO.
Now time to shake things up. We are up and set for our next panel. These men and women are in the business of creativity, and I have to share this story. While we were trying to curate this panel, we reached out to an entrepreneur who simply asked us, why do I need to create something that is big? I want to keep my business small and meaningful. How refreshing is that? Please put your hands together for Joseph Radhik, a photographer who's shooting for stars. Shilpa Sharma, co-founder of Mustard, an interesting Bengali and French restaurant born in Goa. Designer Ruchi Tripathi of Indigene, and singer Shilpa Rao. Moderating this panel and this conversation is Vivek Prabhakar, co-founder of Chumbak. Vivek, over to you.
Basically, we're going to cover a couple of things in the four entrepreneurs that I have seated with me. We're going to cover their journeys. But firstly, I'd like to spend about 30 seconds each, maybe introducing yourselves and what you do, and then we'll jump right in. So go ahead, Joseph.
Okay. Since I'm a photographer, I decided to actually show some photos to you guys. So can you guys play the presentation, please? So this is a story about a photography company started by a couple of non-photographers. We are very excited to be here. This is what we do. We shoot weddings around the world. We're a six-year-old company who literally eat probably the best food on the planet every single day. And we get to party with a whole bunch of people in the most beautiful of places in some 30-odd countries around the world. And we get to see stuff like this. You know, the photos we share seem to be seen by a whole bunch of folks. And some of these folks are slightly popular as well. So you might know these guys. And this is not just in one culture, but this is across cultures, across all types of Indian weddings. This is our story. This is it's a photography company started by two brothers. This is my mom took this photo, so obviously, you know, we had it on our jeans. My brother's sitting right there. I'm not a single photographer. That's the funny thing. It says photographer, but we are actually a company of 30 plus individuals. Our average age is 25, so most of the time we look like this at the weddings.
So wait, single, not single meaning available, or you're not like bunch of photographers?
We are a bunch of photographers.
But you're single?
I am married.
Okay. Just double checking, go ahead.
We get featured in publications all the time. It's a nice thing to be doing this job. And we've been lucky enough to be recognized by a few companies around the world. I'm a Sony ambassador. And finally, this is how things look like when they're at the wildest at a wedding. And I'm going to end it with this number. It's infinity. It's all the love we receive at the weddings we get to shoot and be at, and all the love that we get to give back with these photos. Thank you.
My name is Shilpa, and I'm here today to talk about a complete passion project called Mustard. My partner Poonam and I co-founded Mustard 3.5 years ago in Goa. Now, there was an opportunity that pretty much landed itself in our lap in terms of a space that became available. And we figured that Goa already has about 4,000 eateries, and they didn't really need yet another food place. So if we had to do something, we had to be different. And we curated a concept which is French meets Bengali over mustard as an ingredient. So it's not fusion food, it's French, and a standalone French menu and a standalone Bengali menu. We've been in Goa for about 3.5 years, and I think the admiration and appreciation that we got from our guests from Bombay and Bangalore made us take the leap of faith and bring mustard to Bombay. We opened in Bombay about 3.5 months ago. Aside from mustard, I also run an experiential travel company, which is called Breakaway. And we curate what I like to call beyond the brochure experiences of India. What I also do is run Jaipur.com, which is India's most beautiful product, handcrafted, high-end design product selling online to audiences all over the world. So yeah, I mean, between the three businesses, I firmly believe that the need to succeed at all that I'm good at shouldn't take over my life. So there's enough and more time to do other things.
Hi everybody, I'm Ruchi Tripathi, and I'm the co-founder for a clothing label that's called Indigene. We are set up in Delhi, but we are a conscious clothing label. Why I say conscious is because We connect with grassroots artisans and communities in various parts of India to develop clothing that's purely using the Indian traditional textiles. We are very, very conscious of the amount of pollution that the fashion industry creates, and we constantly work towards sustainable textiles and sustainable design in our range. Our clothing is, we call it wear it all day kind of clothing, something that you can wear to work and then end up in a party in the evening. Indigene is about 6 years into its existence, and over these years, we've been present at boutique stores in India and globally. We've showcased at fashion weeks like Lakme Fashion Week in Mumbai. So yeah, that's about Indigene. If you're looking for Indigene, it's more about passion for textiles and artisans of India. Yeah.
So you're going to talk an introduction, or you're going to sing an introduction, or how's it going to be?
So basically, I sing, I travel, and I eat together.
There's no. We're going to come back to the singing part, but yep. I think, Joseph, let's start with you, right? Mm. So a wedding photographer, but that wasn't what you woke up one day, and like when you were young, and saying that this is what you wanted to be, right? And we were talking about this, saying that when you work with clients, I'm sure because the way you guys are structured also is like an agency, for good or bad, whatever.
Yes.
But a lot of these questions come up to you and say that, I'd like it this way, these are the kind of photographs I'd like, and hey, look at these Facebook albums or Pinterest kind of things, and
correct.
That's the kind of stuff that I'd like. Where do you draw a line between what a client brief is and then sticking true to your art and putting your stamp of Joseph on this?
Firstly, you're being very politically correct.
Yeah.
Typically, the questions I get asked, apart from Pinterest photos, is, bhaiya thoda photo le lo na? Right?
Bhaiya thoda photo le lo.
Yeah, so, you're a wedding photographer, that's what it is. If there's one line that I've embraced over the years, and recently I got married, and I can understand it even more. It is that as a service provider, you should be of service.
Okay.
Right? I think that's the crux of it. And so if we are delivering 100 photos, I believe at least 90 should be there to make that client happy.
Yeah.
Because the client in this term is not just a client, it is a bride on probably her biggest day of her life, right? And probably that day may not repeat, right? And I believe that they should just, it's photography is there to make them happy. But then also there is the caveat that no art is art till there is a bit of you in it, till there's a bit of the creator in it, right?
Yeah.
So the other 10% is literally me. And my journey all through my goal at least is how many clients will see those 10 and keep hiring us for those 10, right? The rest, I take the most boring photos 90% of the time, which is four people standing together, drunk, not drunk, smiling at the camera and a flash, right? The photos that you see here though are us.
From the heart.
Yeah. From the heart, okay.
So and tell me, who took your wedding photographs?
Very good question.
And were you like concentrating on the wedding or looking and saying, hey, uska exposure thoda kam hoga kind of thing?
The problem with being a photographer is you're very conscious as to where the camera is all through. So it wasn't a very pleasant experience at my wedding. My photographers came down from Canada. There are two photographers whom I've idolized over the years, and it was a dream to work with them. But it was during, since I'm on the question anyway, it was during the course of that collaboration, you could say, that I chanced upon exactly what Indian weddings require.
Yeah.
Relationships are what is important to us.
Yeah.
And in the West, wedding photography is about the couple, right? So I have a bunch of great photos of myself and my wife.
Amazing.
Not so much about my aunt, my Masi, and so on, which now I sound like any other bride.
Yeah. So we quickly move to Ruchi. So you talk about, you've got this philosophy that says, put it on, go anywhere. Talk to me a little bit more about that. What kind of got you to say, hey, sustainability is going to be the core of what we do? So talk to me about how did this come about?
The idea behind Indigene, of course, in the first place was to create something that anybody and everybody could use a lot. A lot meaning that you could wear it every day, you could wear it through the day, which from where we came with this idea of comfortable clothing. Both of us, me and my partner Jaya, we had worked a lot with Indian textiles, and that is what we wanted to bring forth through whatever we did in Indigene. Sustainability, we try to operate at different levels. We work with artisans, with grassroots artisans. So that, of course, is the base of Indigene. It always has to be working with traditional artisans who practice textile making. We started with a bunch of artisan communities in like five parts of the country, and we decided that we have to keep working with them year on year. So it's not about choosing a different artisan partner for every collection and then forgetting the previous one, but year on year working with the same people, growing along with them. Like whatever Indigene is doing, it's also, it's basically growing together. That's one another important aspect of sustainability.
So tell me, when you met these artisans for the first time, did they look at you funny and say, hey, listen, who are these two girls who've come and met me and saying that hum ye banayenge, wo karenge kind of thing? Or were they like, hey, this sounds something fun which I've never done?
So I think the good thing was that we didn't start Indigene straight out of college, which is something that we really value even now. All the years of experience that we gained working with artisans for 7-8 years before we started Indigene, and while we were still toying with the idea of taking the plunge, that really helped. And in the in this course, we met a lot of artisans who had who kind of got to know us and knew what we did. So it was easy to break the ice with artisans at that point.
At that point, okay.
Yeah, there was a slight level of trust there, which helped us a lot. And I mean, that's one piece of advice that we always give to new designers, is that take your time before you set up your label. That's really important.
Awesome.
And I think for, again, the last thing about sustainability, as I mentioned earlier, is about being conscious about your waste, is really something that we are focusing.
I mean, I tried to, but yeah.
Yeah, we like to do, I mean, we try to do it in a small way, using up our own waste as of now, but we're making it a practice so that it becomes part of the Indigene identity.
Okay. Yeah. Shilpa, let me come to you. One of these discussions that we've had, like of a great singer versus a successful singer kind of question, right? Is there a difference? And what kind of, what is that difference between a great singer and a successful singer?
Well, I think that's a question for everybody. What you love to do and how much you love it. Yeah. And is that a sort of a stepping stone to getting what you desire in life? For example, does your car matter? How big is it or how expensive it is? Does it matter how big your home is or how lavish your lifestyle is? If you need to maintain that, obviously, then your work also speaks for it. So it's always the need and want.
So do you believe that there's some compromise in between that says that, hey, listen, I'm going to, Joseph said that these 90 photographs I'll do for the clients. Mm-hmm. But in your field also, are you like, I will do these songs and not the ones that I really love, but because these songs could be more successful?
I've been lucky that way. I've been asked to come and sing songs that are just me. Fortunately, most of the composers let me be me. Yeah. They've never tried to change the way I sing or the way I sound.
Yeah.
But yes, it's a daily struggle where you should be, where you want to be. For example, for the past 1 year, I have started doing a ghazal performance, which I've grown up doing. And so I was packing up for, I think the Rekhta, which happens in Delhi. And that was the first time I was doing a full ghazal set without touching Bollywood at all. And my dad, I mean, he's a man of few words, and he says, there are people who work in a bank and they realize they need to paint or cook food or write or sing. So I think you're doing that now. Just because you sang before doesn't mean you were doing something that you love to do. So yes, I'm doing this. It's it's not easy.
Yeah.
It's because yes, you have like 90% of the crowd because they know your song, so they come and ask for it.
Yeah.
But then you need to do what you need to do.
You need to put yourself up front once in a while.
Yeah.
Awesome.
It's not that bad or it's not that difficult.
Yeah, yeah.
You can pull out that much time to do this for yourself.
That.
For yourself, actually.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Thanks. So coming to you, let's jump off the tough part, right? Three different industries. There's hospitality, there's travel, there's retail. One part of the question was what led to the other? And second is like, you know, do you carry a lot of learnings and more importantly, a lot of stress from one business to another? Or do you like compartmentalize them and work them as three different kind of companies?
There are many questions rolled into this.
Yeah.
Let me try and address them one at a time. Three different businesses, what led me to go from one to the other? I didn't make any plans. I think the opportunity just came about and I decided to go for it. Everything that I do and everything that I've done in the last 8 years of being an entrepreneur, I think is a reflection of the person I am. And that in itself is that in itself has affected what I've chosen to do with Jaipur, with Brickway, and with Mustard. You know, I mean, the need to be significantly differentiated as a proposition. Look, the point is that, you know, there's enough and more people out there with very, very deep pockets. And if I have to be an also-ran, it's evident to me that sooner or later somebody with deeper pockets is going to come and wipe me out before I've even woken up. So the only way to stand out really is to do it differently. And if it means swimming against the tide, then so be it. None of it really seems like work. You know, it doesn't feel like work. I mean, I get asked this question all the time. How do you do so much? And I'm like, I wake up in the morning and I know what I want to do and it doesn't feel like work. There's no rigid pecking orders aside from some grief from investors.
I think that's something that all of us...
No, there is some grief from investors from time to time. But that aside, so, you know, I've never really had to think about why am I doing this? So that's one. There are many lessons that you learn from experience. And I think way back then, when I first started with my travel company, which came before Jaipur did, there was really no one to learn from. There was no one really to go up to and take advice from. I had worked in FMCG and the retail space for 20 years before deciding to be on my own.
Yeah.
And the ecosystem today is very, very enabling and very, very willing to help. But way back then, there wasn't, right? Nobody was willing to talk to you. And least of all, somebody, you know, from the travel trade would turn around and say, oh, but you know, we don't think you get it. And, you know, plus I'm trying to build what you're wanting to build. And, you know, I've been in the business for 10 years.
So a lot of free advice.
So a lot of, well, you know, enough and more reason to push you in a corner and not let you, do it. But, you know, I mean, I'm also a fighter. So I was like, okay, you know, I'll show you. But the truth is that you learn lessons every day.
Yeah.
Lessons from your own experiences, lessons from other people. I mean, you know, we all wake up in the morning thinking we're the only ones who've thought about a certain idea, right? I mean, that's all bullshit because the truth is there are enough and more people out there who tried to do it and either succeeded or failed miserably. And for me, it's always been about go out and find those people and talk to them and understand from them what they did right, what they did wrong, learn from them so that your learning curve is not necessarily as long as someone else's. You know, today I teach and I mentor. And I think that the youngsters today who are all raring to go and work for themselves and set up their own businesses have the advantage of an ecosystem and a support structure which is miles ahead of what, you know, you and I had those many years ago. And they can make informed choices.
So the
learning never stops, right? You learn lessons every day, but you do not allow stresses of one business impact
the other.
Oh my God, we'd have disaster on our hands if I carried stresses from one
across
to the other.
Businesses.
No, you don't.
Yeah. Joseph, I'll ask you a question. So these 300 plus weddings that you've been to and shot at and covered in various forms, you're literally that little fly on the wall that need not be noticed but also noticed, right? Can you give me an instance of where, you know, like any anecdote where you've actually like gotten into like trouble with like either side of the family or like hey, aise karo, waise karo, or a drunk uncle or something like that?
I had a drunk uncle ruin my laptop.
Yeah.
But apart from that, not very much.
Do you get a lot of pushback from the family? And like, as I said, free advice. Do you get a lot of free advice from the family?
No, I think you nailed it when you said the fly on the wall bit.
Yeah.
It's just that it's like you're a friend, though.
Yeah.
I have noticed that humans ignore people who are known to them.
Yeah.
So when there's a stranger in our midst, you are suddenly very conscious.
Yeah.
You're very conscious. Everything changes about your body language, everything else. Whereas how you behave when you're with friends is very different. And for me, I have to be a friend.
Mm.
So yeah, for me, the biggest challenge though through all of that is to look beyond the grandeur, right? Look beyond the, irrespective of who's performing that night or how much deco is there or how much jewelry is there or what dresses are being worn, and is to somehow find the emotion behind all those layers. Right, that is my biggest challenge.
So does the photographer get to complain about the good, the bad food or not really?
I think by the time I have my dinner, I think everybody's
it's
already
cold.
Finished dinner. Yeah.
Thanks so much, Joseph. Shilpa, will shift to you. This entire process of actually putting a song together, right? When do you know that a song is done? When is it complete and saying that I'm now ready to hand it over to the world kind of thing?
When you hear a song for the first time, I think the spontaneous reactions are the most potent. Your first 10 takes are the most natural and beautiful that go with the song. After that, you become calculative and... So I'll just run you, take you through the recording process. So I'm inside the booth, someone who's sitting outside and recording me, that person matters a lot.
Yeah.
That person can tell you whether it's working, because what he's hearing is a different set of ears. So he is also supposed to tell you when to stop. And for me, I think, of course, the melody of the song and the lyrics, that these are the two things that matter most. For example, I was singing Bulaya, and Amitabh is a very good friend. He had written, I think, the first draft of it that was quite bad. And I was like, I mean, what happened? You know, your second part of the song is so beautiful, and Amit gets the better lyric, and I don't. So he said, you know, wait, I'm still working on it. So anyway, I sang something and I left. A year and a half afterwards, I went back to record it with those lyrics, and they were
magical.
They were magic. And it takes time. This is 1.5 years. There are songs that I've sung 4 years ago, 5 years ago, and they're releasing now. You really don't know how it happens.
You know, with a whole bunch of music that keeps coming out every day, in fact, are there, do you sometimes sit down and feel, hey, listen, this is something that I could have sung better? Or do you feel this sometimes? Or like, it's okay, you sing what you sing?
Actually, the song comes to you.
Yeah.
It wasn't yours, so it never came to you. I think with time, you get patient. Like how Shilpa said, you know, like, you get patient with time. What you should be doing. And it's not how much you do, but you sing those two lines and you sing those five lines in a song that are magic, and people remember you for it. So that's about it.
Can creative businesses scale, right? I mean, do any one of you have a lot more vocal? Do you want to take that, Shilpa, and close it?
Yeah, I'll take that question. let me start off by saying scale means different things to different people. I will not speak for creative businesses overall, but I can only speak for the three businesses that I've had an opportunity to work with over the last 10 years or so. Jaipur is a business which is being built to scale. So yes, we will totally scale. There is enough and more of an opportunity. We're here as a brand which happens to be online first. We are building an offline presence, but between our online representation and the offline presence, it's a business that'll scale. Breakaway is bespoke journeys which are all immersive experiences. And I firmly believe that experiences and scale don't go hand in hand. I mean, something's going to have to give. So I don't think with the choices that we've made about, you know, for Breakaway and the way we like to curate our experiences, those experiences are not meant to scale because quality is certainly going to, you know, have to give, and that's not something I'm willing to compromise on. With Mustard, the whole intent behind Mustard really is to find ways and means to showcase regional cuisines in the country. We've got 29 states, and we've got multiple, you know, parts of the state. I mean, you know, there's nuances within each state. So, you know, Ahmedabadi Gujarati food is very different from Kachi Gujarati food, and so on and so forth. So, there's tremendous amount of opportunity. But then, you know, there again is my definition of scale.
Awesome. Yeah. So, yeah, so I'd like to end this by thanking all of our panelists. Thank you so much. And it was a pretty interesting conversation. Thank you so much.
I'm going to request for our giveaways to be handed out. Please accept this token of appreciation.
CNBC TV18 Young Turks Conclave, powered by SBI YONO.